Hello and welcome. You're watching Sunday Politics live on Channels Television. I'm Kayode Okikulu here in Lagos. Tonight, we begin with one of the biggest policy pronouncements of this government in recent times. Well, in less than 12 hours from now, students across the country are expected to resume academic activities, physically, that is. Well, this particular decision was really contentious even before government gave the green light on Thursday through the Ministry of Education. So it wasn't really a surprise to hear members of the House of Representatives kicking against that decision. Well, the House Committee on Basic Education and Services says that now is not the time. In fact, rather than resume tomorrow, the committee is asking the government to wait for 3 months before allowing children return to schools. We'll be speaking with the chairman of the committee in a moment to give us more context to that. But let's give you some background into how states have been internalizing and handling this resumption issue, because not all states are resuming tomorrow. Well, some states have already resumed last week, while some are pushing it forward. So here's a breakdown. You can see schools that have resumed already. We have states like Oyo, Cross River, Rivers, Zamfara, Gombe, and Abia states, as well as some other states. So those are states that have resumed already. They didn't wait for the federal government's PTF's decision, well, through the Ministry of Education, to resume tomorrow. They resumed based on their states, you know, the PTFs in quotes they have in their states. So those are states that have resumed already. Well, some states are waiting till tomorrow based on the PTF's guidelines. So let's take a look at some of those states that will be resuming tomorrow. We have, of course, Lagos, Delta, Kwara, Kogi, Plateau, Sokoto, and some other states who will be resuming tomorrow. And interestingly, Kwara State split it, with tertiary schools resuming on January the 11th, while primary and secondary schools will resume tomorrow. So it's some sort of hybrid for Kwara State. But it's an entirely different story for Edo State, where the government is holding off resumption till February the 1st. And that's based on the trajectory of its cases having grown over 84% since March 2020. So for Edo State, they didn't resume last week. They're not resuming tomorrow. They say, well, not yet really for us. We're going to wait till February the 1st. So as you can see, it's different strokes for different folks. Or do I say different dates for different states? But this is a very serious issue because it concerns the health of millions of children, your children. And we are joined tonight on the program by the Chairman House Committee on Basic Education and Services, Professor Julius Iovera, who issued the statement on behalf of the committee titled School Resumption, Are We Truly Prepared? Good evening, Prof, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you very much. Good evening.
Great to have you. Well, it's less than 12 hours to that planned resumption of schools nationwide. The government, the federal government, thinks it is safe, but you clearly don't agree. Why?
Well, it's very simple. We are not saying that schools should not resume. We are not saying that we do not recognize the pains of the students, the teachers, the proprietors. We know COVID is here for a while. We must find a way to live with it. But in reopening schools and sending our children in there, have adequate preparations been made? The answer is no. I mean, if you look at the state capitals, yes, you may see some evidence of some action, but step a minute outside the capital, there is nothing going on there. In fact, simple public education to let people know about the COVID protocols are not going on. Some states dismantled their facilities just after, before the second wave. So what we are saying is that there should be a proper monitoring, proper investigation to ensure and confirm that the schools have been prepared properly. There are protocols set by the NCDC. There's a template prepared by the Federal Ministry of Education on school readiness. How many states have met these protocols? That is where the problem is. We're not saying schools should not reopen. We understand it. But our position is that we have not prepared adequately for it. And we should take it as an emergency, as an urgent issue, and begin to work hard to make sure that our children will be safe.
Okay, a couple of issues you have raised, really, and we'll try to see if we can break them down so we can take a look at this holistically. But when you say, I mean, adequate preparations have not been made, you referred to some schools that have dismantled some of the things they had in place to curb the spread of the virus. Are you saying that the government, the PTF, the Ministry of Education, did not consider these issues before saying it's time to resume?
You see, we have a federal system arrangement. Basic and primary education, even university, are on the concurrent list. State universities are there. So the states are quite free to adopt their own time, whatever time they feel they are ready. But the issue for us is this. If you look at the template for school readiness established by the Federal Ministry of Education, not up to 10%, you know, of the laid out guidelines have been implemented at the state level or local government level. The schools have no, how many schools? 95% of our primary schools have no water. And arrangements have not been made to procure buckets that could be used as an alternative. They have no facilities for anything. These classrooms are crowded. Some have no furniture. They sit on the floor. We have not made arrangements for this. So even if you say children are asymptomatic or their immunity system is much stronger than that of adults, what about the school workers? What about their parents they go to meet at home? They come back to school, the teachers. The template of the Federal Ministry of Education requires setting up a school health team. It requires setting up a database on the health status of instructors, trainers, and learners in the schools. How many states have done this? That is, that the parents will be confident that the teacher that my own child will be interacting with is COVID-free. I mean, we should not take this thing as a joke. We are very concerned. We have children. We want them to go back to school. But we are not sure that states have taken this matter seriously. Some have. For instance, the Federal Ministry of Education requires that a creative and innovative mechanisms should be adopted to raise money. Ekiti has done excellently there. You know, on their own, they've raised enough money to fix health centers and begin to fix schools. But many states think this is a joke. They are not taking it seriously. Go to many local governments. People are not wearing face masks. They are shaking hands, hugging each other, attending weddings, and telling you when you go there that, yeah, take off your face mask. There's no COVID here. People are dying in the villages. But they don't get to hospitals, and nobody examines. There's no autopsy to see whether this is COVID or not. So this is an opportunity for government to rise to the occasion,
right,
and do the right thing now.
Well, speaking of government, I mean, a lot of Nigerians would like to know just what data you are relying on, because at the onset of this pandemic, the PTF said that they would use scientific data to arrive at whatever decisions they come up with in the course of this, you know, battle against COVID-19. And looking at that statement that the Federal Ministry of Education put out, it was said that the ministry had undertaken a comprehensive appraisal of the situation, went on to say that after extensive consultations with relevant stakeholders. So it would appear as though the government actually looked at data. So what data are you looking at? Because you say over 80% of schools are not prepared. Do you have data to back this up? Did you conduct any survey?
I'm the chairman of the Committee for Basic Education in the House of Representatives. And I work very closely with the Universal Basic Education Commission, where you have data about the number of schools, number of teachers, etc. I have members who have provided data before we put out our release on the condition of schools in their respective constituencies. I can share some of those photographs and you will be amazed that this is Nigeria. That is one fact. The second is that they have not given us any data to say, oh, we have vaccination everywhere, face masks is widely used, people are adhering to the COVID protocol. This is not happening and we all know it. The figures were less than 500 when we closed all the schools. Today, they are getting close to 2,000 infections per day. And we know that less than 20% of many states are not doing any tests at all. This is clear. If you check the infection rates, it is obvious. You can draw the paragraph. If you Google even NCDC data, they will tell you that most states are not tested. This is going on mostly in Abuja, Kaduna, Lagos, Oyo, Ekiti, and a few other places in the south like Kimo. But in other areas, nothing is happening. The facilities are just not there. Okay? But if they want to do it, they can do it. Because one of the requirements in the federal government template for school readiness is repurposing funds for school readiness and for COVID campaign. How many states have repurposed their funds to deal with this emergency, like many other countries are doing in the world? So the data we are using is actually the federal government's own data. But the federal government's own data does not get to the grassroots. The states are the ones that have the capacity to get to the grassroots, the way the majority of our people live, to churn out the data. But that is not happening. So we should not just take what people discuss in Abuja as absolute fact. As someone who goes around this country, as someone who interacts with people in government and in the private sector in the rural areas, and my colleagues that cover the entire country in their constituencies, the situation is not good. And we should not take it for granted.
You know, this brings up the issue of collaboration, because that statement again says there was extensive consultation. So if you say that UBEC, for example, gave you data saying over 80% of schools are not prepared, and you have a government saying in some sense that based on the data we have, we believe we're prepared to resume. So does that mean that that data was not presented to the government, or it was presented and government did not look at it enough, or we're talking about different data here?
What I'm saying is that UBEC's data showed clearly the condition of our schools. No, it has nothing to do with the COVID. But my committee has access to the entire country, the constituencies, in practical terms as to what the reality is. I also represent a constituency, and I know the situation there. The argument we are making is not to bandy data around in Abuja here. We are saying outside Abuja, outside the metropolis of Lagos, outside the capital cities of the 36 states, what is happening in the rural areas, in the peri-urban areas, you know, leaves much to be desired. Governments are not engaging in serious public enlightenment campaign. So people are not taking it seriously. And if you're not taking it seriously, there are many people going about with COVID who have been infected, and they're infecting others. We're not trying to raise an alarm here to scare people. But what we're simply saying, let us do the right thing at the right time. Have they purchased sanitizers? Do they have face masks? Have they installed water pumps in the schools? I'm not asking for boreholes now, but get somebody to supply water and fill the buckets regularly and put extra buckets so that children can wash their hands. Are they arranged to have two streams so as to create social distancing in the classroom? Or are you still going to put 50, 60 children in one room? Those are the issues. Have the teachers and the learners be instructed adequately on COVID-19 protocols? The answer is no. These things have not happened. We can deceive ourselves if we want. But when the consequences come, we hope some people will be held accountable and be ready to stand up and take responsibility. These things have not happened.
I don't know
what data they say at consultation. Who are they consulting with? People live in the capital cities. Commissioners. He said they had a meeting with commissioners. And on the basis of that, 27 states forced them to change. Because the minister himself has said the date was not sacrosanct. It was going to be reviewed. They were going to change it. And suddenly, he met with commissioners and he changed the date and said 18 was not available. Fine. I've taken time to even visit a few schools. Nothing is going on. So we're just sending these kids there without proper facilities, without proper environment. The learning environment will not be conducive for them.
Well, really, I was going to talk specifically about your constituency, because that can help us understand maybe what's happening across the country. Now, you said that in your constituency, schools are not ready. Now, the question will be, whose responsibility is that? Because you have said that someone should take responsibility eventually. So who should be stepping in to ensure that schools are ready at the constituency levels and all that, beyond just the PTF and the Ministry of Education making those pronouncements?
That is true. It is a federal system. You have local governments, you have state governments. In my own constituency, I, in the federal house, had to fumigate schools, fumigate markets. I had to produce sanitizers. I had to produce over 10,000, 15,000 face masks and distribute that to people. We had to engage in public campaigns and encourage people to use the face masks and sanitize and wash their hands with soap. We had to procure some buckets and pumps because there's no water anywhere. You know? So the local governments in the country, in the 774 local governments, are not proactive. They're not doing anything. Few may be responding to the governors when they see the governor. But once the governor is not there, nothing is happening in most of our local governments. And they have a responsibility to do these things. They get allocation every month. State governments as well. I said earlier on, funds have to be repurposed. The federal government said that in its own templates for school readiness. You have to look at your priorities, reprioritize, and say, all right, We're going to do this. How do you send children to schools where there is no water, where there are no chairs? You have not put in proper place proper social distancing. It is true that children are not dying as much as you have for adults all over the world, but it does not mean that children have not died of COVID. It does not mean that they are not carrying the COVID virus and they can infect adults.
Okay,
I have a colleague who... Yes.
Right, you can land on that just before I put in the next question, please.
Now, I was just going to say, I have a colleague who got it from her husband and gave it to the children. So the point is, there are certain steps a state must take. Have they presented to the federal government, the Federal Ministry of Education, Federal Ministry of Health, or to the PTF or NCDC, a program of action that they have undertaken with checklists to show that this has been done? How are we going to monitor and evaluate compliance to the COVID protocols? These things have not been discussed.
Right. You see that states have, you know, taken different decisions. They've internalized this differently. And I try to give a list of, you know, different states and how they're approaching this. Some resumed last week. In fact, some resumed just a few days after the new year. For some, like Edo State, they're not resuming tomorrow. They've postponed it by two more weeks. So clearly the states have a huge responsibility, a huge part to play in this. And I think you have spoken to that. But in terms of data, because yes, you've talked about, you know, children not dying as much, not being infected as much. In fact, the NCDC figures shows that, you know, for children less than ages of 10, the percentage is much less. And I think we've had about 8 fatalities so far, as you can see on the screen there, for 11 to 20 or so. I mean, the debt is not as much as you find for 31 to 40, 41 to 50, and 51 to 60, and the rest. But clearly, we still have those figures. So in terms of data, because data is quite important in this fight, do you have any projection as to what might happen now that schools are reopening and you feel, or you say that data shows that a lot of them are not prepared? Do you have any projection as to what might happen to our figures, what we might see in the coming weeks or months as a result of this?
In the case of Edo State, I think I commend the governor there for at least shifting to 1st of February, though I also doubt that they will be properly ready as at that time. I come from one federal constituency, and I know that no action so far has been taken in the primary schools to say we are reopening on February 1st. But there is time to do that. This is not rocket science. Now, the only projections I can make at this point, based on what I have, is that in the next 3, 4, 5 months, you will see that the adult population in our schools will have a sad story to tell. The universities and polytechnics may not be as affected because they have large halls and they can do social distancing. And those are more matured students and they can at least respect the COVID protocols, particularly if the universities on their own mount enlightenment campaigns regularly. Not just, you see, the problem with this country is that we do things halfway. Go around many of the banks and public places. You will see where they installed sanitizers. As soon as the first sachet empties out, they don't replace them.
Okay,
you put
Prof.
your hand under it, nothing comes out.
Pardon me for coming in at this point. I'll let you land in a moment, but we're due for our break. I mean, you've raised that important point. So when we return, you'll continue on that trail of thought because, I mean, a lot of people are calling this risky resumption. For some others, they say it's inevitable. Life needs to go on. So when we return from this break, we take a look at some other issues concerning the resumption of schools. This is the health of our children we're talking about, so it's important. Join us again. Welcome back to the program. We still have with us Professor Julius Yombere, who's a chairman House Committee on Basic Education and Services. And we're discussing the resumption of schools tomorrow. Yes, less than 12 hours. I know a lot of students are probably preparing already. Some are preparing to go to bed so they can wake up early enough to go to school tomorrow. So, Prof, you were talking about, I mean, scenarios you have seen, how people seem to abandon those protocols just right after the first few days. Lethargy, a lot of people have called it that. But in this case, we're talking about the health of our children. You are going to land on that point. So let me just let you land on it before we talk about what we experienced with the previous safe reopening of schools. So please land on the statement you were making before the break.
Thank you. The point I was making, and I was so happy when you said it is the health of our children. It is their safety. It is their future. It is better to lose 3 months and ensure that things are put right than to rush in there and end up with mass graves. God forbid that that should happen in this country. We're already suffering the impact. The template that has been produced by the federal government, which states can easily obtain, is very clear. The template requires the first minimal package, minimum. They're not telling them to do those guys, minimum package of COVID materials should be provided in all schools. It requires that they take protection and well-being of the students as primary. They should have one gate, in exit and entrance, so that everyone can be tested. Many of our schools have no fence, they have no gates. People come in from all directions. It requires that the learning of these kids has to be in a safe environment. Staff health, a database must be established that the teachers are COVID-free, security men are COVID-free, the bureaucrats in the schools are COVID-free before they can be allowed to go into the classroom. It requires inclusiveness. The people who are physically challenged, how do you ensure they return to school safely? I mean, I can go on and on with some of these. These things are very clear. The point I'm making is that from the evidence available to me in my committee members and available to members of the House that I have interacted with from across the country, these steps are not being taken. Where they are taken at all, it is in the major schools in the capital city. Beyond it, attention is not being paid. And I want to plead, I want to beg that governments should see this crisis as an opportunity to do the right thing. The private sector is ready to contribute money. Ekiti did it easily, raised over 800 million and over 200 million in kind support for the government to get the work done. So I think for us, if we do not put this in place and put in proper monitoring and evaluation mechanisms, we'll just be doing motion in a barber's chair, a lot of movement but no progress. And if there's no progress, we'll be exposing our children to danger. And this is what we are trying to avoid. My committee deals with primary schools and secondary schools, and we are saying they are not prepared.
I mean, one wonders what's holding states and local governments back from putting these measures in place. But I asked you earlier about the projection. But, I mean, in terms of data, we can try to predict what will happen based on what happened in the past. So if we could just step back to August last year when we had that safe reopening of schools. I'm sure you recall that gradual reopening. You know, we had students in the final year resuming to write their final exams. And in October, we had some sort of full reopening. So based on what we saw then and what we're faced with now, did you see, is there any correlation data-wise that we can sort of juxtapose and say this happened then, so it can happen now? Is there any correlation?
That is pretty easy. That is pretty easy to do. In the first wave, we were not doing enough testing. Some state governors were saying they were locking out COVID. Some were saying COVID did not exist at all. And a few just pretended that they could not be bothered. So one cannot say that the data we obtained from the first wave is so reliable we can make any projection from it. No, I will be the first to say that is not scientifically possible. But we can read the trends. At that time, we closed markets, we closed schools, we sold shopping malls, entertainment centers, places of worship, because we wanted to reduce the infection rate. And the infection rate never went above 500. Daily infection rate never went above 500. Then we began to reopen because we thought the COVID was over. People went back to their normal lives, to their usual things. They were shaking hands, hugging each other, attending large weddings. There was one in Lagos with over 1,000 people in attendance, with no face masks. And the second wave came. And more people are dying now because the infection rates is going up. Luckily, the death rate is not moving as fast as the infection rate. But the infection rate has quadrupled, which means we should actually be much more cautious, much more careful, pay more attention to the science of taking care of our people. So the only projection I can make is that based on what we have seen so far in the infection rate, which has been a minimum of 1,000 per day, going to 2,000, it means that the infection is increasing. Maybe testing is also increasing. And that if we do not do the right thing as the committee is asking for, the consequences will be much more serious.
Can you really say certainly that, because this is particularly about schools reopening, can you really say certainly that it was because of the schools resumption we had in August and then in October that our cases increased? Is there any correlation?
No, I will not say that, because you remember that this same committee fought very bravely to ensure that our students wrote their WAEC at the right time. But we also said there must be adequate preparation for social distancing, and WAEC did that. They almost tripled the exam centers, tripled the invigilators, ensured there was social distancing, people wore face masks, and people used sanitizers. And they did it successfully. Okay? Now, I cannot say it's because of the reopening of schools. I think it is more the reopening of places of worship, the reopening of shopping malls, even movies. But there were some controls during the Christmas and the New Year, though many ignored it. Unfortunately, I've lost some very, very close friends. I went home during the Christmas, took chieftaincy titles and all of that, and they died. They are dead as we speak. Rather, I would think it is because of the downward spiral of the adherence to COVID protocols that has caused this current wave.
Well,
and if we now encourage that process by not providing the required protocols for our children who are going back to school, then the figures are likely to go up one way or the other.
Well, Prof, with you saying that there's no correlation really for you between schools reopening then and our cases rising, some will say you have scored a point for those saying that schools can resume tomorrow or should have resumed already. But this also dovetails in some sense to this talk about a national lockdown. If you're saying that schools should not reopen yet, are you also favorably disposed to a national lockdown, seeing how our cases are rising?
I do not think we need a national lockdown now. I think what we need now, in the first instance, is serious controls. Let me say, the governor of Lagos is a poster man for the fight against COVID. The announcement, if we see you outside without mask, we'll arrest you and charge you to court. Simple, that is the kind of courage we need now. People moving some money for entertainment in government house and for this, and putting them to buy sanitizers and distributing to all schools, getting buckets and water, procuring owners of tankers to take water to schools because there's no borehole in many of these schools. In fact, I don't know of any primary school that has a borehole, so to speak. So the issue is not a lockdown. If you lock people down and you are not doing the right thing inside the lockdown, the cases will still increase. They will break it. They will challenge it like they did during the first lockdown. So the real issue is to bring out the policies and implement them. The federal ministry as a supervisor, yes, states have autonomy, but we give the states money from UBEC every year. Every year, they pay counterpart and they give them millions, billions. What are they doing with this money? We should investigate more. This is the time to retool and repurpose. Money from UBEC should not be put in the fight against COVID.
Right.
Well, Prof, let it be comfortable.
Okay,
we're not doing this.
On a final note, Prof, we talked about collaboration earlier, and you've said time and again that your committee was not consulted in this whole process. And as we wind down, on this is the final question on this, as we anticipate what comes out of the resumption. Just what level of collaboration are you looking at? Would you be submitting some of your findings and projections to the PTF, the Ministry of Education? Just what kind of collaboration are you looking at moving forward?
As a committee, our primary function in the National Assembly is lawmaking. And then, of course, we are involved in the process of appropriation of funds. And I think in the last budgeting process, the National Assembly demonstrated its concern by supporting the increase in the budget for the Ministry of Health, Ministry of Education, for security, and so on. So at that level, we're ready to cooperate. We work hand in hand with all the agencies in the Ministry of in the education sector, with the ministry. I do not know why they didn't bother to consult us when they were consulting commissioners at the state level, but that has happened and that should not delay us. We will be interfacing with the two ministers in the ministry. We'll be interfacing with the heads of the various parastatals, and we will make our findings known to whatever agencies are necessary. The NCDC, the Minister of State, and the senior minister normally represent the sector in that committee. So for us, we're open, we're prepared, and we keep doing it. That is why, if you look at the UBEC budget, most members of the House put their funds, constituency funds, in the education sector to build schools, to build toilets, to put water, to build offices.
Right.
And then all of us engage in constituency outreach.
Okay. Well, Prof, I have to come in now. I know this conversation is a major one, but we'd like to thank you so much, Professor Julius Sionvere, who's the Chairman, House Committee on Basic Education and Services. Thank you for expanding on this, and we do hope that the very best is what lies ahead for us as a nation.
I hope so, too, and I thank you very much for this opportunity, and I hope Nigerians would be more careful and recognize that COVID is here, COVID is real, and it kills.
Well, thank you very much, Prof. Well, let's turn our attention to another matter. And interestingly, it has to do with a date also, January the 15th, 1970. Does it ring a bell? Well, it is one of the most significant dates in the life of this nation, Nigeria. And it is not as popular as October the 1st, quite all right, but the events leading up to that date still resonate in almost all spheres of the nation's polity. We have chosen to commemorate that day as the Armed Forces Remembrance Day. And the natural question to ask is, what are we remembering? Well, for one, we're remembering the end of the Nigerian Civil War, also known as the Biafran War. Nigeria has come a long way since that incident, which almost tore the nation apart. It's been 50 years, but as you might agree, the scars still remain, especially for those who were directly and indirectly affected, like the armed forces. The men and women of the Army, the Air Force, and the Navy paid, and they continue to pay, huge sacrifices to defend the nation. They didn't go to bed after January the 15th, 1970. In fact, they've been actively involved in peacekeeping across the continent. You might remember ECOMOG. The Nigerian military was basically the backbone of the Economic Community of West African States Ceasefire Monitoring Group in Liberia and Sierra Leone. And for over a decade now, we have lost gallant soldiers in the fight against insurgency. And yet they continue to give more because this war is not over. So tonight on the program, we ask, what's next after all the pomp and pageantry, if you may, of the Armed Forces Remembrance Day? Beyond the comments and the insinuations around the pigeons that seemed reluctant to fly, how do we ensure we continue to do right by our soldiers? Tonight on the program, Honorable Babajimi Benson joins us via Zoom. He's a chairman, House Committee on Defense. Good evening and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening. Thank you for having me on the program too.
Well, you are at the Armed Forces Remembrance Day commemoration in the nation's capital, Abuja. Yes, there was a lot of talk about the pigeons, which is a symbolic part of the ceremony. So if you could just tell us, what was that event meant to achieve, essentially?
Yes, thank you very much for the question. The event, as you all know, was to commemorate our armed forces. They fought gallantly during the Civil War. Some of them fought during the First World War and the Second World War. And a lot of them are going through the crucial battle with the insurgents in the Northeast. The armed forces, as you well know, in Nigeria, they are involved in about 36 operations throughout the length and breadth of Nigeria. So it's a day to commemorate them, January 15, to show them we care, to show them they're part of us, and to also show that we are with them in a battle to ensure that Nigeria is free and safe and that Nigeria attains the eminence that its good qualities offer.
Well, you know, it might be difficult for a lot of people to appreciate the journey of the Nigerian Armed Forces holistically without a look at some of its antecedents. You've touched on some of them, but from the Civil War to, in fact, the coups, a lot of people will talk about the coups and, of course, the rest. So just how much have those events shaped our armed forces to what we have today?
Yes, the First and Second World War, the Civil War, are landmark events that happened in the days of yore. The Civil War, particularly the armed forces, is very, very involved in the democracy we're enjoying today. They helped ensure that peace was attained in respect of the Civil War. And in the present day Nigeria, the insurgency, the armed forces have played a yeoman's role in ensuring that no territory in Nigeria is ceded to the ISWAP or the Boko Haram insurgents. So they're playing a critical role in stabilizing our democracy. And I'm sure in the fullness of time, their good works will also ensure that we are still continue to enjoy this stability and a lot more.
Okay, we're going to get into some of the things we need to start doing, I mean, after that event. But, I mean, you sit in that committee as the chair of the Defense Committee, and I'm sure you hear a lot of stories. Going for that event, leaving that event, and, you know, juxtaposing that with the stories you have heard, some of the, you know, sad stories, really. What did you leave there with? Did you leave with a resolve? Or really, just help us understand, what did you leave that event with?
Okay, I left there with a lot of purpose in my heart, a lot of respect for the armed forces, a lot of encouragement, a lot of KPIs that we're also going to set to ensure that the armed forces drive us to where we want to be. We're not there yet. A lot still has to be done for them. A lot of welfare issues, a lot of also making Nigeria understand that the armed forces they're not a separate entity, they're part of us. A lot of their men and women are members of our family. The armed forces is paid from taxpayers' money, so we pay them, so Nigerians pay them. So Nigerians own them. So I don't want, we also realize there's a bit of detachment. The Nigerians see them as just an armed forces that is not part of us. So I went away there thinking of the Nigerian Orientation Agency needs to do more, needs to be able to speak to all Nigerians in the nooks and crannies to ensure and to knock it in their heads or in their consciousness that these armed forces belong to us.
Right.
So we must also be up and doing when it comes to providing the intelligence, information, and things that would add value to what they do.
You talked about KPIs. It's something we usually hear in the corporate world. Yes, I mean, you've sat at different corporate board meetings. So it's interesting to see how you bring this to bear when it comes to defense and the armed forces. So let me begin by asking you, over time, when you've looked at the budgeting and, you know, different policies and the rest that we've come up with for our armed forces, would you say that we're doing right by them well enough?
That answer is an emphatic no, and I'm going to just oppose that answer with one of your data analysts, Ogusawo. I watched him a couple of months ago, and how he captured his thoughts really left an indelible mark in my chest. He said that he compared the defense of the Man City football team and compared it with how much Nigeria is spending in defending its territorial integrity. It was an abysmal comparison because the Man City defense spends higher on its defense than Nigeria is spending on protecting its territorial integrity. So when it comes to funding the armed forces, there's a lot that can still be done. We also understand that there are other priority projects, there's health, there's education, but we're not funding the armed forces as much as we should be doing. And that also has to do with inflow of what we get. I understand that, but we need to find journeying on out-of-the-box ways of funding the military. Because show me the effectiveness of your military, point to its inventory. The inventory we have can still be upskilled in a lot of ways.
You know, when you talk about spending, really, it involves the welfare, also equipping, really. It's a whole gamut. So help us understand, if you can, where are we right now? You could tell us where we're coming from, but where are we and where do we need to get to in terms of that spending for welfare, for the well-being, equipping and the rest?
Okay, when it comes to welfare is good because under this administration, the commander-in-chief of the armed forces and the president of Nigeria recently signed a document called the MAFA, which gives priority to the welfare of the armed forces. It's an unprecedented act that he did, and I must commend him tremendously for that. When it comes to inventory, so the welfare, so far, so good. The inventory is where I have the slight problem with. We need to upskill that. We need to be able to purchase equipment in a very nimble way. We also need to create additional funding so that our military are better equipped than they are now. So I'm saying that the military, when it comes to equipment, can do a lot better because, like I said earlier, show me a good military and I'll point to inventory and platforms they have. We're not there yet due to paucity of funds, due to the way the world is nowadays. But we're still making, we're building blocks, and I'm sure within the end of the administration, we'll be able to upscale and be quite where we need to be.
When you say we need to purchase military equipment, platforms and the rest in a nimble way, what do you mean there?
Yes, I mean that, okay, it is only in only very few countries fund the military on the balance sheet, on the budgets. So in Nigeria, for instance, our military is funded by the envelope system and the budget. This doesn't allow us purchase or buy equipment as nimble or as quickly as possible. So the parliament, in its wisdom, is thinking of setting up an armed forces support fund that would also allow other sources of funding to come into military procurements.
Okay. Now, still on procurement, a lot of Nigerians will remember, you know, last year, that video they must have seen on social media of General Adeniyi, you know, speaking about the military's resolve in the fight against insurgency. But then he was asking for equipment, basically saying, well, this is what we have. It's not enough firepower to combat the terrorists. In fact, he was talking about some of the equipment that had been damaged. But still, he said, we're in this fight. So when we talk about procurement, really, a lot of Nigerians will remember that case. And it begs the question, where do we place that in this, you know, whole gamut? It's probably something you have considered also. So how do we place that?
Yes, back to what I was saying, that, yeah, we need to spend more on those equipments. We need to ensure that the logistics are in place to pinpoint the equipments to where they're most appropriately needed. So I'm saying that, yes, a lot still needs to be done in procuring inventories and platforms and firepower. The General Adeniyi video, we learned our lessons, and I'm sure a lot has been done to ensure that such occurrences are few or far between.
Well, the other side to that is the court-martial and what played out right after that. And for some, it ties to welfare, because a lot of people, especially on and off social media, said that leaves a bad taste in the mouth. So also, if we could factor that in, how should Nigerians internalize what played out then with the pronouncement of the president, for example, saying that the welfare of the military is top priority? How do we put all that to the pot, really?
Yes, like I said earlier, Mr. President signed the MOFA Act in 2017, which places priority on the welfare of servicemen. Where we have the issue, again, I want to make a distinction between welfare when it comes to salaries, emolument, debarment pay, security. They get all that as and when due. The issue that we've always had is equipping them with light weapons and heavy weapons. And there's also the issue of international politics that is being played out. Even when you have the funds to procure the inventory, not every country wants to sell to you due to international politics. But they've been up and doing. They've been finding creative ways of getting the weapons in. And weapons are not things we buy off the shelf. It takes a bit of time. It takes opening LCs and production. And so everybody's, all hands are on deck. And I believe that by 2021, a lot of this equipment that have been purchased will be coming into. One of it is a Tucano airplane that we're expecting by mid-July.
Right.
Mid-year.
Okay. So that's on the one hand. But just while you were talking, we showed some pictures of, you know, pensioners, military pensioners appealing to the president to pay some of their allowances. And, I mean, this again leaves a bad taste in the mouth. I wonder if you're involved in this. Really, what is being done? Because, I mean, as you can see, these people made big sacrifices for the country, and this is not the best way to repay them. Do you agree?
Yes, I do agree, and I'll go back to the act Mr. President signed. He signed the act in 2017, and what the act seeks to do is it takes care of only people who retire post-2017. So those pensioners that are protesting retired before 2017. You know, so they're saying they too should be entitled to the debarment law that was signed in. But we've taken their protest on board. I'm sure it's receiving the attention of the Minister of Defense at the moment. Once that is done, once they pass it to us, we will now take appropriate actions in looking at how we can create a preparation for it. But it's an ongoing discussion that we're having, and I'm sure there'll be a closure before the end of this week. Second of all, has to do with the minimum wage. Minimum wage is being paid at the moment at 30,000 per month to remember, but the pensioners also want a piece of that pie to say that, okay, the monies should also be benchmarked at the new minimum wage. So that's also an ongoing discussion that will be deliberated and resolved within the shortest possible time.
Okay, on a final note, Honorable Benson, a lot of our soldiers are probably not watching this right now because they're probably engaged in some operation, one operation or the other, but we have to do right by them nonetheless. You talked about those KPIs. We have a year ahead of us, really, to ensure that we meet those KPIs. So I'd like a case where we can always refer to this interview at the end of a year and say, well, we ticked this off. We ticked this off. So run us through the KPIs you're looking at your committee and in collaboration with the ministry also for our soldiers, both past and present, to ensure that they are well taken care of. What are those KPIs on a final note?
The first KPI is to ensure that the insurgency, which is harming and hurting Nigeria, is brought to its logical end by the end of this year. Mr. President has said that at many forums, and we're holding the ministry accountable as well to that. We also are looking at a place where there will be appropriate synergy between all the services. We've seen that. If you look at the December, the Chief of Air Staff went to Maiduguri to have lunch with the Army. You know, that's a sign of synergy. And furthermore, recently the Air Force bombarded the Boko Haram territory, Aswa, in proper coordination, proper synergy with the Army. So we're seeing a new year, a new beginning, and a more committed Nigerian armed forces towards ending this insurgency we're facing. So it's those two KPIs that I think will be at the front burner to ensure that this world is ended in the shortest possible time.
Well, Honorable Babajimi Benson, Chairman House Committee on Defense, thank you so much for your thoughts, and we wish you the very best.
Thank you so much.
Well, that's our show for tonight, everyone. Many thanks for watching. I am Kayode Okikiolu. Don't forget to stay safe. Good night.